Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for listening to my talk. Today, I will be discussing epistemic responsibility in science. And I'm going to begin by motivating the question, like, what exactly is epistemic responsibility? And what exactly is collective epistemic responsibility? If you open up a science journal today, you'll find almost every single paper is going to be written by a team of scientists. For example, here's a paper from 1994 from the Collider Detector at Fermilab, the CDF collaboration, with over hundreds of physicists, and this is a paper announcing evidence for the top quark predictions at p-bar-p collisions. You can see the discovery of the top quark is done by this entire team of scientists. So how is this team of scientists epistemically responsible for the discovery of the top quark? Of course, this question is quite fraught even within science itself. Here I just pulled some articles and headlines from Nature and Science, and you kind of see this question of how is credit divided among co-authors in these large collaborative projects. Scientists themselves don't really know how to think about this. This is an area of active dispute, and authorship disputes are quite common in science. For example, the question of who and how should we give the Nobel Prize in physics when physics is all done in groups. So here is a picture of the Atlas collaboration. There's over 3,000 physicists working in the collaboration. So in the photo here, you can kind of see this is a small subset of the people who are just on site that day. Most of the people who work at Atlas are sort of all over the world. You don't really, you know, of course they don't fit into that photo. Atlas is a detector at the collider at CERN. And there was over 5,000 physicists listed on the paper that announced the mass of the Higgs boson, which is a major discovery in physics. So who is epistemically responsible for the discovery of the mass of the Higgs boson, and how should we give the Nobel Prize for this discovery? Does it belong to all the people who are involved? You can see this in this photo. The Nobel Prize, of course, for the Higgs boson has been given to three physicists, theoretical physicists who have written on, who have sort of theoretically predicted the Higgs boson. But of course, these are things that are part of what it means to ask about epistemic responsibility. But it's also not when things go right. Of course, epistemic responsibility also arises when things go wrong. So here, perhaps you heard about this from a couple of years, from a few years ago, where the opera collaboration, collaboration at the opera detector, observed neutrinos traveling faster than the speed of light. So they observed this neutrino in 2011. OPERA has about 160 physicists who work on this project. The announcement was so controversial that over 30 physicists removed their names from this paper. As you can, and of course, in this paper, you see that you don't even see the full author list, right? You have to kind of click around in order to see the full author list. Of course, we know by the laws of special relativity that particles with mass cannot travel faster than the speed of light. Neutrinos have mass, therefore the neutrinos cannot travel faster than the speed of light, and or even at the speed of light. And so if this discovery turned out to be true, it would have been an amazing, extraordinary discovery. Of course, that ended up being a false discovery. There was an error in the equipment set up at OPERA that they very quickly discovered towards the end of 2011, and they had to sort of recant their discovery claims. So I think all of these sort of cases that I'm bringing up here in the beginning brings up very naturally to this question of who is epistemically responsible for the results of collaborative work. And I just want to note really quickly here that what I mean by epistemic responsibility, right, is very different from those who work from dothastic agency, people who ask whether or not we have control over our beliefs. So I'm asking a slightly different question here, even though I think the phrase get used kind of, it's the same phrase that gets used, but I mean different thing here. But why do we even need a concept of epistemic responsibility to begin with? Well, I think it is because of the incentive structure of science. Epistemic responsibility is essential to adjudicating both blame and credit in science. I think in our practice of science, in the epistemic practices of science, we have a very natural practice of rewarding people for their epistemic achievements and also punishing people for their epistemic failures. So funding decisions, tenure decisions, giving prizes, you know, like the Nobel Prize, all depend on figuring out who is epistemically responsible. But the answer, of course, is not very obvious in collaborations, and scientific collaborations is now the norm in science. Gone were the days when single authors were sort of the norm in science. Charles Darwin wrote The Origin of Species, and he is the one who's sort of solely responsible for the contents of The Origin of Species, for the theory of evolution by natural selection. Of course, there's Wallace, who discovered also natural selection, not together, but it was a concurrent discovery. But if we're looking at the book, right, on The Origin of Species as an epistemic output, Darwin, right, is the one that stands in the proper relation to it. But when the set of authors is a huge collaboration, it's harder to answer this question. So I think there's a couple of possible answers. We might think it's the collaboration as a whole, a group agent is responsible, sort of a collective agent. Is the agent that is responsible. We might think no one is responsible, that in fact, in these cases of collaborative science, the question of epistemic responsibility kind of just drops out. There's no one that we can hold responsible. We might think it's every single member, that the epistemic responsibility kind of decomposes to every single member of the collaboration. And you might also think maybe it's some subset of members who is responsible. For example, you might think that it's something like the operative members. So here I think, you know, here are sort of, I think, the four possible ways you can go on this question. What I'm going to do today is argue that for sort of the third option, which is that every single agent in the collaboration is epistemic responsible. However, I'm going to argue that they're going to be responsible in different ways. Epistemic responsibility is, in fact, several different kinds of responsibility, and every single person in a collaboration is going to be responsible, but in different ways. And I think we need to rethink what responsibility means in these cases of collaboration. Since I only have 20 minutes, this is a sort of short talk, I'm not going to be able to go super deep on my positive view. So I'm going to spend actually most of the time, the rest of my presentation today, arguing against the sort of the two other options on the table, that is the collaboration as a whole is responsible, the group agent account, and also the no one is responsible account. So I'm going to argue against these other possibilities, and then at the very end, give you sort of a glimpse of what my positive contribution would be instead. Okay, so So in philosophy of science and in people who've written on the social epistemology of science, the question of epistemic responsibility kind of goes hand in hand with the question of scientific authorship. Scientific authorship and adjudicating scientific authorship is, in fact, the central place where questions about epistemic responsibility are raised. Who is an author? Who counts as an author? Right? These are the kinds of questions where the core concept we're investigating would be epistemic responsibility. But however, most people who've written on in this area or have thought about scientific authorship think about the case, like take as paradigm the case of the single author or in an individual case. Again, think back to Charles Darwin's relation to the origin of species. That's the relation that that we want to discover, right? We want to recover from these collective cases as well. So I think so what do these cases look like? So there are the people who work on sort of this, who Brad Ray, who work on sort of, who has been writing quite consistently now, pushing a group agent account. And then more recently, Bryce Huebner, Rebecca Kukla, and Eric Winsberg in two separate papers, although their authorship order changes in these two papers, the three of them have argued for this kind of no one is responsible account. So I'm going to take these two in turn. So Brad Ray has argued that we should generally conceive of papers produced by collaborations as being authored by one collective author with one collective voice that speaks in the scientific paper. He's very inspired by Margaret Gilbert's accounts of joint acceptance, and he thinks that a co-authored paper in science is a paradigm case of a joint acceptance, and that the co-authors together form a true group subject. On the other hand, Bryce Huebner, Rebecca Kukla, and Eric Winsberg have argued that there is no one who is truly responsible for the results in large collaborations. And here I have pulled a quote from them from their 2017 paper, where they say, neither individual nor multiple nor group authorship is plausible in radically collaborative research. So what they mean by radically collaborative research are just sort of large collaborations where the collaborators are spread out across time and space, at least in anything like its current organizational form. As things stand, authorship simpliciter remains impossible in most radical collaborations, right? So here I think they are very clear, right, that there is no one who is an author, who's a true author, right, in the cases of large scale collaborations. And Brad Ray, on the other hand, right, argues that it is a collective author that is the true author of these large, of the outputs of collaborations. Okay, so I'm gonna take these two in turn and argue why we should reject these views. So first, why should we reject the group agent account? Well, first, I think it's an empirical question whether or not scientific papers really are written as a truly collectivist document. And I think that there is good empirical evidence in sociology of science that say that these documents are not sort of, they're not collective documents, or they're up to negotiation among members of the collaboration. They often, sometimes they only report a view that's a subset view of, only represents the view of a subset of people in the collaboration. So this is an open empirical question, and I do think the empirical evidence points the other way. There's also a more theoretical problem of how a group agent is formed. So Brad Ray is really inspired by Margaret Gilbert's account of the plural subject, where members jointly commit or accept a view or an action to be the view or action of the group. However, complexity and size of scientific collaborations make forming a plural subject very difficult. if not impossible. And Margaret Gilbert herself, right, has said that her account doesn't work so well as the size of the group gets bigger and bigger. So I think, and I think this goes back to whether or not this is an empirical question, whether or not scientific groups actually do jointly commit. And my sense is, I think a lot of sociology points to the fact that they are not. The incentive structure of science is also, incentive structure of science is also based on individual scientists. So there's an ultimate need to evaluate individuals for either hiring, tenuring, or giving grants. These things are very hard these practices that we have, right, that depend on evaluating individuals within collaborations, I think are going to be really hard to capture if you think that the collective agent is the only sort of truly responsible agent in these collaborative settings. We also need to figure out, right, who to invite into a collaboration or who to exclude. So there has to be some way, right, that if these practices are commonplace, that there is some way that we can sort of, that we're judging people beyond their standing in a collective agent, right? So again, I think these practices that are sort of individual based points to a individual based kind of epistemic responsibility that's not captured by the collective responsibility picture. Finally, positing a group agent does not actually elucidate the concept of epistemic responsibility in science. Collective responsibility in science ends up looking a lot like individual responsibility. Again, we're still looking for that same relationship of Charles Darwin to the origin of species, except we swap out Charles Darwin for the group agent. So I don't think this is a very promising strategy. Against no one's responsible kind of accounts, so I'm going to say a little bit more about why Huebner, Kukla, and Winsberg have this view. So they argue that for someone to be accountable for a scientific claim, she must believe that there is a coherent set of epistemic and methodological standards that govern its production, and she must take responsibility for defending those standards and explaining how they are met. This requires the ability to know how all the pieces of the research fit together into a coherent whole. And of course, in big collaborations, there is no one who can kind of play this role of being able to explain how the pieces of the research fit together because of this problem of epistemic opacity. And epistemic opacity occurs whenever epistemic labor is distributed. And there's sort of three ways that epistemic labor is distributed. So there is a problem of complexity, where the research is so complex and historically contingent or path dependent that it is beyond the cognitive ability of a single agent to fully comprehend. The problem of values and methodological decisions are made locally and informed by local values, which are opaque to other collaborators. And finally, problem of expertise. Different researchers are using different disciplinary expertise, which cannot be evaluated by other collaborators. Therefore, because of this kind of all these sources of epistemic opacity within a collaboration, there is no one who is in a position to be accountable for the entire study. No one who can explain all the methodological decisions. No one who can kind of go back and trace the entire steps in a study. So, Huebner, Kukla, and Winsberg, they're not wrong, because of course there is no agent within a collaboration that can be responsible or held responsible the same way as we would find and hold a single author responsible. What I think has kind of gone wrong in this view is that they, in fact, focus too much on the connection between epistemic responsibility and giving justification. So if the represented results are challenged, there may be no single justificative story to be told about the methodological choices made and the epistemic standards used, not even one that we need to be told piecemeal by various participants, right? So here they are very clear that the kind of epistemic responsibility they're looking for is just is an agent who is able to give a justification. And there is no agent in a collaboration that can give the entire justificatory story. And they think that this can't be done also by a group agent, by positing a group agent. It can't be done by a subset of agents, right? By told piecemeal by various participants. And I don't think any one person can do this. So that's why they think that no one, right, is responsible, because no one can give justification. So I want to argue that this kind of view, right, no one is responsible, is not very helpful, right? The current incentive structures of science will collapse if there is no responsible agents in scientific collaborations. And I believe that the most promising way forward is to look for a different concept of epistemic responsibility, one that does not take the single author or the individual case to be paradigmatic and opens our evaluations of epistemic responsibility in science beyond justification. And the view that I'm partial to is, which I have developed elsewhere, is a tripartite account of epistemic responsibility, where I argue that responsibility actually decomposes into three different kinds beyond justification. So one, an agent can be epistemically responsible for a collective claim that P, if that claim can be properly attributed to the agent. So there has to be some causal connection, the right kind of causal connection to an agent. And an agent can be answerable for a claim that P insofar as an agent is able to report reasons and justifications for holding that P. So here, responsibility is answerability, sort of that sense of responsibility that captures justification. And of course, there's accountability, in which an agent can be held accountable for a claim that P if it is appropriate to blame or praise the agent for asserting that P in accordance to epistemic norms. And an agent can be responsible in one, two, or all three senses of responsibility. I'm really inspired by work in moral philosophy, especially people who work in philosophy of action, David Shoemaker, whose work sort of inspires this kind of decomposition of concepts of responsibility. But unfortunately, I've run out of time, so I won't have time to go into detail about my positive proposal, but I hope I have kind of convinced you that we should at least reject both the view that where there is a group agent and the view where no one is responsible. All right, thank you very much.